Good evening. Today we will play with this ElectroDragon WiFi Relay Board. It is actually an ESP8266 development board that is able to control mains current. As usual, I connect the TX pin of my microcontroller to the RX pin of a USB to serial converter. And vice versa, the RX pin of the microcontroller to the TX pin of the converter. Pay attention that for these two signals, your converter must present 3.3 volt logic levels. We shall make use of this 5 volt power supply pin as well, and let this switch to handle its connection to the 5V pin of our development board. Normally, this board would get its power through this step-down transformer directly from the mains electricity of your home country. But as the lid of the board is now removed and these high voltage wires are exposed, it wouldn't be safe for us right now to take the power from the mains current plug. This time we are not going to use any Wi-Fi connections, so using this relatively weak power supply from my computer's USB port will be sufficient for us today. This wire comes from the ground pin of our development board, this one from the ground pin of the serial to USB converter, and these three ground wires come from this RFM69 radio module, and together they form the common ground of our system. If I attach to the radio module a simple antenna, and these five signal wires from the ESP8266 microcontroller and supply the radio with 3.3 volt power, we see that our microcontroller starts getting temperature measurement values from this thermometer that I placed into my freezer a while ago. So, this is our topic today. If you have ever tried to make Wi-Fi thermometers with your ESP8266 microcontrollers, you already now understand what a treasure would be a wireless thermometer whose batteries would last for one whole year, even outdoors in your garden. Thermometers such as this Dostmann 30-31-43 are that kind of treasures. Let's take a closer look at this our wireless weather station and firstly get acquainted with the so-called serial peripheral interface bus. The ESP8266 microcontroller usually uses the GPIO 12, 13, 14 and 15 pins for the SPI communication protocol, and at those cases you can use Arduino IDE's standard SPI library. But here we can't use that library because this development board has already occupied the GPIO 12 and 13 pins and uses those pins to control these two mains current relays. So, to handle an SPI interface here, we have to make for it a program of our own. It isn't difficult. The page 44 of the datasheet of the radio module tells us that for its SPI interface, a microcontroller must offer three digital output pins and one input pin. Well, let's write a piece of code that reserves the GPIO 2 pin for the SPI bus's so-called MOSI signal, the GPIO 4 for a MISO signal, the GPIO 5 for a serial clock signal and the GPIO 15 for a slave select signal. ElectroDragon has made at least three slightly different versions of this ESP relay board. My board is not shown on these pictures, but ElectroDragon's this web page is otherwise quite valid for our purposes. For instance, on the board that I have, the GPIO 15 and GPIO 2 pins are represented at these pin headers 15 and button 1. But there must be an error at this table or on the board itself, because the GPIO4 pin that is represented at this pin header is misleadingly named as 5 question mark. And the GPIO5 is in an equally strange manner named as 4 question mark. So, when you buy your board, test with your multimeter where your GPIO pins actually are. Despite its this poor quality, this $5 board anyhow does deserve our attention, and let us now continue with the program and, for starters, reset the whole radio module to its default state according to the guidelines from the page 76. The board has a built-in connection from the microcontroller's GPIO0 pin to this button 2 pin header. From this soldered version of my radio module, it is even easier to see how the blue jumper wire connects that button 2 pin to the reset pad of the radio module. As we now want to do something with one of the registers of the radio module, we must first pull down its slave select signal. According to the page 15, we must now wait for at least 30 nanoseconds, so this 1 microsecond should do. After this, the first of 8 bits that we are going to write to the MOSI line is a bit 0, that is indicating to the radio module that later we are willing to read an 8-bit value from some of its registers. If you go back to the page 44, you will learn that in this radio module, the so-called clock polarity and clock phase both equal to 0. According to the Wikipedia, this means that such an SPI module reads a new bit right after that the microcontroller has made the serial clock signal to rise from 0 to 1. By waiting for another 1 microsecond, we give much enough time for the radio module to complete this reading process. We don't let this digital read command to disturb us right now. We'll talk about it after a moment. We just set the serial clock signal back to 0. Now, let's continue in similar manner and tell to the radio module the name of the register that we are now interested in. These 7 bits, 000, 0011, form the name of our this register. It is a binary number, but you may refer to it as a hexadecimal number 3 as well. We now take the leftmost bit of those 7 address bits and write that bit to the MOSI line. In other words, we set the GPIO2 to low. And again, a rising edge of the serial clock signal tells to the radio module that now comes the right moment for it to read a bit from the MOSI line. Repeating these steps, we write 5 times 0 and end with writing twice the bit 1. And now the radio module is aware that we want to know the content of its register number 3. We now repeat the previous steps. This time it is totally meaningless what bits we send, but during the process, if we listen to the MISO line with this digital read command, we will get from the radio module some 8 bits that are the content of its register number 3. And by pulling the slave select line back to its initial state, we indicate to the radio module that we are now finished with reading. To upload this new program to our ESP8266 microcontroller, one must first open the Arduino IDE, then select, for instance, this Node MCU 1.0 and select the connected USB port. Power down the microcontroller, wait and give a few seconds for these big capacitors to get empty. Start pressing this flash button, turn the power on again, release the flash button, and finally click this upload arrow. When the program is uploaded to the microcontroller, you may have to shortly disconnect the power in order to reset the microcontroller and to make it start running our program. But as you see, this time the program started running by itself. Here, this hexadecimal 1A was the result of our reading. From the datasheets, page 60, we learn that this 1A is the default value of the register 3. So it seems that we have just managed to read a valid value of our radio module's 1 register. Writing new values to registers is easy too. This is the same piece of code, but now it is organized a little better and it is easier for us to read. And this time there is a bit 1 that precedes the 7-bit address of our register, and that first bit indicates to the radio module that after a while we want to write something. But first, of course, we must tell the same 7 address bits to the radio module. If we now write to the MOSI line the bits 00000111, in other words, if we write to it the hexadecimal byte 7 and run the program, we see that we are able to change the value of a register from its default value to some other new value. I am very grateful to Albert Lopez, Francisco Javier Sanchez and Fred Bossard for the following information that I now share with you. If we use our new SPI functions to write these values to these 15 registers, we get a radio that is able to hear the broadcasts from this wireless thermometer. In other words, we get a radio receiver that listens to these 2 frequencies for broadcasts at the speed of 17,241 bits per second and doesn't get disturbed by the frequencies outside this customized bandwidth. If the receiver finds a row of these bits, it writes down the next 40 bits that are to come and after that sets a certain 1 register bit high to indicate for us that a message is ready to be read. Here we have a simple program that checks if that 1 bit of 1 certain register is high. If it was high, the program reads 5 times the content of the register number 0 without pulling the slave select signal high between those 5 readings. And it will get these 5 bytes that contain the desired 40 bits. If among the received bits these 7 bits are 1101010, the program considers the message as valid and then counts and shows us the result of this formula as the measured temperature value. After that, the loop function of the program will repeat these same steps over and over again, and the radio module receives and the serial monitor shows us new and new temperature values. Here I have written some new lines to the program so that it keeps this relay switched on always when the measured temperature is below, say, 21 degrees Celsius. And here you see yet another slightly different version of the ElectroDragon board. This is the 4th variation that I have seen of the same board. This version continues to have the misleading 4 question mark and 5 question mark markings. It is of course good that ElectroDragon tries to make its board better and better, but it is regrettable that, for instance, the order of the mains current relays can change from one version of the board to another. It is also a pity that none of the versions has screw terminal places for the mains current earth wires. And that's one thing why I assume that these fascinating boards aren't accepted by our European authorities. Well, anyhow, let's play our new radio module so that it won't touch any unwanted wires of the relay board. Pay attention that to achieve short wires to this radio module, I have here changed the order of the GPIO pins that I use for the SPI connection. These small leads are cable clamps and work as strain reliefs. Screw also them to their places. As we now haven't got any serial connection to a computer, I use this original Dostmann receiver to show us the newly measured temperature values. As you see, the both devices are showing the same room temperature, that is approximately 21.5 degrees Celsius. Let's try our system now with mains current. The relay board is going to control this white lamp. If I now place the thermometer back to a cold environment, we see this lamp turning on at this very moment when the measured temperature drops below the 21 degrees Celsius that we had in our program. And these lines of code enable us from this moment on to upload our new programs wirelessly over the air so that we won't need to open the lid anymore and we don't need to be near those potentially dangerous high voltage wires anymore. It is possible to improve our this wireless weather station in several ways. Many of those improvements will be discussed in the description of this video and in our next videos. Thank you, TFA Dostmann, ElectroDragon, Hope Electronic, iThinker and Arduino IDE community for your fine products. And thank you for your time this evening. Goodbye.